If I could call some order, please. We started a little bit late. Thank you for bearing with us. I'm now officially open for the meeting. Before we go to the public session, I'd just like a few things to say. The first one is, I'd like to thank everyone that was involved with the Christmas Festival. That's not just councillors, that's especially members of the public as well. I think it was a great evening and a good success for us. I would like to just draw to everyone's attention special thanks to Paul and to Carol for their work above and beyond. Thank you very much. Second item, I just want to remind people that are attending the meeting that are non-residents, please don't interrupt the meeting. You have no right to speak at this meeting. You're totally welcome to observe, but please don't disrupt our meeting. This is sometimes very important business and we need to get through it.
What are you looking at me for?
You see, you've done it straight away. Don't interrupt the meeting.
Number three.
I have opened the meeting. The meeting has started. Do it again. Don't interrupt. That was number three.
Thank you.
Yes.
Your courtesy.
Protocol of meetings. If the chair feels that he's losing control of the meeting, and I've never had to do this before, but if I stand, everyone sits down.
Oh.
Councillors and public, and you're quiet, because this is one of the most important parts of public meetings for the chair. If I stand and it's not observed, I will move for the meeting to be suspended there and then, because if it gets to a point where I've got to stand, control of the meeting is lost. Right. Thank you for your patience with that. I will now move on to the public session. Also, can we try to keep quiet in the public part, please, because it's important that we can hear what we're saying.
Looking at me.
Number one, Vic, please.
This is from the Taylor Green Book Group, due to an answer. It regards the playing field off the end of Merkdale Avenue. I must make it clear, I don't want to get into the argument of whether the council actually own the land in order to sell it, because the intention is to sell it for development. So this is the question. I don't want to get into that argument. The question is, regarding the covenant on the playground on Birkdale Avenue, will DTC write to RNBC to inform them that RNBC have a moral obligation to maintain the covenant on the land gifted to the community and expect them to maintain it? And to Sir Kevin Barrow, requesting him as a constituency MP to support the covenant on the land. Thank you.
Just a little bit of information for the members, some may not be aware, but I think we have actually had a vote of support about that covenant. So that's just a little bit of background information for you. I'll open it to members. Do you think we should? Members in support?
Yeah, I'm sure that we...
Oh no, it exists. That's the point.
Yeah,
support, yeah. Yeah, we've already shown support for it. So if members have agreed, just a show of hands that we do the letters.
Thank you.
The question is basically, even though the council object to building on Greenbelt, there seems to be an inconsistency because you have basically come to a private arrangement with a number of parties to support selling off a third of the miners' welfare, which is Greenbelt. So I just wanted to know how you can square those two ends.
I just need to just clarify something, because the question here is the question that will go into the minutes.
Right.
And you've put apparent support. Can you explain apparent?
Sorry, could you?
I've got to be very accurate, because you've put, and this question is what we will put in the minutes, and you've put given their apparent support. Can you explain apparent?
Yeah, I mean, as far as I can find out, you appear to have supported it. I mean, I can't 100% verify that, right, because I wasn't, invited to that meeting.
100%, but I'll open it to members first.
You've not supported it at all.
Right. I was at the meeting, and it was raised that we are 100% against building on Greenbelt.
Right. The acting chair, last meeting, Councillor Cottam, said that you had agreed to support the Friends group in whatever they wanted to do with the land, essentially. So what you've done is you've given quite a very small part of the community kind of final say over a very important asset which really belongs to everybody. So, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, in my book, that is completely unacceptable. It should have been done in an open forum, and everybody who lives in Diddington should have had a say in what happens with that land.
Well, I said last meeting, this was a personal statement, not the council, this was my personal statement. I said that if the majority of that committee wanted to build a few houses on there for the benefit to save the rest of that area, I'd support them.
Right.
Now, you said it's about Greenbelt.
Yep.
Perhaps, I got it. When I supported Greenbelt, perhaps I might have been personally wrongly when I did. Perhaps I should have said, in principle, we'll support the Greenbelt. But it's advantageous for small areas to be built on to preserve other areas, I personally have looked at it again.
Right, and do you think that should be decided in an open forum?
That was my opinion.
Right, I mean, I wouldn't necessarily disagree with you, depending on the benefit that comes back to the community.
Right.
The problem I have is that, let me finish this point. Right, well, just to finish the point, as a body, you've taken part in what, as far as I can see, is a secret meeting with the MP, RMBC and the Friends group. This, as far as anyone can tell me, is essentially what's happened. If anyone wants to put me straight, feel free.
We didn't agree to anything.
So
we couldn't agree to anything. There were only two or three of us from council. We couldn't make a decision for the town council.
But those of you who were there as councillors. You weren't just there as members of the public, or you wouldn't have been invited.
Just to observe.
But you were there as councillors representing Diddington Town Council.
How am I allowed to go there to observe a meeting?
Sorry?
How am I allowed to go to that?
Can I just...
Well, I don't know. Was I allowed to come? Probably not.
May I just move it on? The dynamics of this group going over the same ground. Mr Smith.
Well, on the point of the meeting, I'm a member of the Friends of Diddington Miners Welfare. Mr Lewis is a member of the Friends of Diddington Miners Welfare. You, along with the local MP, Sir Nutkin, you got us out. Oh, sorry.
No, just.
You want to call
don't
me
have a name call. We're not on playground.
Who the hell do you think you're talking to?
I'm asking you to be respectful to me.
Don't talk down to me. The point I'm making is you and the chair and the MP, Sir Kevin Barron, forced me and Mr. Lewis out of the meeting. You made a tirade against me, so did Baron, and we were made to leave the meeting, which means that, for a start, it was unconstitutional, because we were members, and we are members, of the Friends of Dinnington Miners Welfare. We weren't allowed to stay in and listen to what was said and take part in that meeting. So therefore, it's an unconstitutional meeting. But knowing someone who was in that meeting, I know that you were told by Baron and by Jones, that Sisvo's COE, that it was going to be built on, Park House was going to be demolished, and you lot agreed to it, so you can't get out of it.
Sorry, I didn't catch all of that.
We're still 100% against building on Greenbelt.
Yes.
But you agreed to demolishing the Park House, and you agreed to building on the Miners' Welfare, on the third of Miners' Welfare. The two don't square up, do they? You've actually got a mandate that actually says, and there's a unanimous vote, that this council is against the core strategy and it's against building on the Greenbelt. That's what you passed unanimously. Now we've got people like Brian Cotton trying to bail out from it, but you can't, because you've got it on paper that that's what you agreed to. But you agreed to allow Park House to be demolished. You allowed them to say that a third is going to be built on. But bearing in mind as well that this council also voted unanimously to have the Miners' Welfare put on the list of community assets. You've completely ignored that. That's meant nothing whatsoever. So you pass motions, or you pass things in this, but you pass things in here and then you ignore them, which is typical of the Labour Party. That's as it may be, but you can't get out of the fact that you did agree to demolishing a Park House and a third of welfare being built up.
Does anybody have any more can say on this one? Because
I'd just like to know when it would go up to this council about his agreeing or taking a vote to knock Park House down or go off the what we passed about Green Belt. As far as I'm concerned, it was laid down in stone here that we're against building on Green Belt. And there's not been a vote come to this council to ask us to agree with building or knocking Park House down.
You're absolutely not right. It wasn't. There were two or three town councillors there that spoke for the whole of the town council. There were three or four people from Friends of Dinnington Miners Welfare who it would seem spoke for the whole of the Friends of Dinnington Miners Welfare, because we weren't allowed to protest against it. But this council, it's never been brought to this council. The only time Miners Welfare got brought to this council is when I brought it and I asked council to put it onto the list of community assets, and you all agreed to do exactly that. But now we're in a situation where Park House has been demolished, and a third of it, at least a third of it, is going to be built on. Now, which way are you doing this? You know, you're like fleas jumping from one dog to another, because you either stand by what you said in a meeting, you actually passed that motion in a meeting and said, we put Park House on this community asset, and then you forget about it. And then two or three of you go into a meeting with MP and with Jones, and planning, part of planning committee of Rotherham Borough Council, and have an agreement to demolish Park House and build on the third of it. Who can trust you? Who
can talk about it all you want. This council has never done anything other than object to building on Greenbelt Lane.
But the few individual councillors who went to the meeting seem to have done otherwise.
No,
and they were acting as town councillors.
Can I just ask you this then? The ones that were there, what protest did you put up about demolishing Park House and building on a third of welfare, which is Greenbelt? What protest did the councillors who were there put up to that?
I don't know what other councillors put up.
You were there.
Chair, wasn't it said that agreeing to so many houses if there wasn't going to be the community centre on there?
There was lots of discussion, but there was no agreements. This is what we're trying to say, there was no agreements. There was lots of proposals, but there was lots of discussion, but there was no
agreements. It was also stated categorically, right, just for that information on that, it was also stated categorically by Siswell that they would have built a new community centre on miners' welfare because they don't have any money.
Right. I have got to move on because we still have three questions. Yeah, so if we go,
you're about when you agreed to it being demolished. First I know about it, it had been demolished.
Was the demolition discussed at the meeting at all? Well, I've been told by more than one person it was discussed and it was sanctioned.
It's not fair to the rest of the public.
Yeah, I believe you. Unfortunately, it's not you who were at the meeting.
Right, if I may move to the next question, please, because we've took quite a lot of time already. The next question is from Mr. Hall.
Well, I'm quite prepared to withdraw my question yet again, actually, if it means that we can discuss this further, because members of the public are not getting answers to the questions. I feel this is totally unfair.
I cannot give any other answer than absolutely no agreements were made at the meeting.
Right, I'll tell you what then, could you give us and publish a written account in the form of minutes of what was said at that meeting?
No.
Why not?
We were taking minutes. We guessed.
Well, three of you went, so between the three of you, I'm sure you could come up with something that's pretty accurate.
Well, actually, I would say that the information, and it's, I will tell you now, I gave you a complete rundown of that meeting within about 2 days, probably, of the meeting. That is the most accurate piece of information.
You put over a certain point of view, but I would have to say that some of the things you told
me. Some of the things
you said conflicted with what other people have said, some of them councillors.
If I was to put anything down in writing, which I wouldn't be able to remember now, but if you took notes on that phone call, that is the most accurate information I could have given you.
Right, why don't we just get everything out into the open and get a written account by the councillors who were there and get it put in the public domain on the council's website.
You have everything that I had when I spoke.
Okay, so let's get it down in writing in the public domain and everyone else can look at it.
Can we ask every councillor on the town council approved about this meeting and asked to attend it? Were all town councillors asked to attend that meeting?
I've had confirmation from the clerk that every councillor was invited to that meeting.
It was very required they sent all this. I remember that everything that paid everything. So Barry and I invited the all, so they were in charge of this all, so you paid for it. That's what I understood. And this is why we got invited.
If he or others didn't take minutes, that's not, that wasn't our meeting.
Excuse me, could I just ask,
Are there no formal minutes whatsoever from this meeting? I'm not talking about DTC here, I meant from the meeting organisers.
No idea. Well, but certainly no one that was there has been given sight of anything.
Well, if there were, could they not be made available? And that would end everything.
Well,
everything be in the open, then, wouldn't it?
Well,
surely I had a
you need to approach the person that called the meeting for that.
I think the Americans would call it plausible deniability, wouldn't they?
So we want to contact Mr. Barry. I'll put this.
Well, back. I'll ask it very briefly. Very quickly.
Well, I was going to say I'll come back to it if we had time, because we've. No, I want to, let me.
Well, I'll ask it now. I just want to ask the Town Council's opinion of the appalling state of the roads in Dinnington and the surrounding area. It's something I keep harping on about, but it never gets any better. And by the surrounding area, I can include Kibberton, Anston and Firkoff. May I also ask what the Town Council will be doing to ensure that the current situation improves in the future. I mean, I know that the latest round of works proposed for 2015 and 2016 have just been released, but I know what happened in the past, that a lot of the money was diverted from this area and used in Rotherham. So I'm just hoping that the Town Council will be quite strong on this and ensure that roads in this area are improved.
I received an email from Borough about 2 to 3 months now, asking for ideas or proposals for the road budget for next year. All members were requested to submit their thoughts. All the ideas that came forward, all the roads that were mentioned, were included in my reply to them, particularly stating the shocking state of some of those roads in particular, and the fact they were on major bus routes as well. Made the representation as to which we deem were the priorities. In the latest round, it would appear that the top one or two of them, particularly sort of New Road area and the Silverdales area, I think Silverdales, part of Silverdales included, the Jig Lane area, there seems to have been ignored. But some of those are right, not all. But the representation is what we felt of the state of the roads, and the roads we thought were good.
I'll come to you in a second.
Yeah, we'll just add a bit onto that, Chair, really, just to. Only a quick one. Are the Town Council aware that there's a new section of footpath being built between Pocket Handkerchief Lane and the Tommy Roundabout?
It's finished now.
And that's costing £100,000, and that's surplus money out of the A57 scheme. Well, I think it's scandalous, because I think that money should be put on some of the roads through Dinnington, especially New Road, because that suffered from the traffic diversion. So, to me, it's part of that scheme to spend £100,000 on a footpath that may never be that heavily used, I think is downright ridiculous.
Well, I'm sure members weren't aware of exactly how much that was, but I would entirely agree with you on that. So we are actively participating in whatever methods we can to try and improve the road.
Thank you.
Right, we've got short for time, so do you think yours would be fairly quick, Mr. Jepson, I think?
It would really. I'm not sure you've got it's item 11C. Is about the precept. Is that going to be in confidential, is that in public session? Because I could tack it onto that if you want to say that at this beginning.
Well, we've got an agenda item to discuss date for the precept meeting.
Yeah, I could do that, but it's only quickly. It's just to ask you, are you aware of, as a parish council at Anston, we've had a letter from the deputy leader saying that there's not certainty that the grant will be passed on to parish and town council this next year. So we're having to do two budgets, one if we don't get the money, and one if we do. And I wonder, I presume you've glad he's had a letter from council, are you not saying about that piece?
I'm actually attending the parish network meeting.
Yeah, well, I'm there tomorrow when it's going to be. But it's just the fact that, you know, are you aware, obviously, you've had that, but yes. As I say, it's obviously going to be time consuming because we've got set two budgets and it's like plotting for, because we haven't got a clue as to what money we're likely to get, so it was just a
we're attending tomorrow and yes, we are going to set a date for a preset meeting around the usual time.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, right, finally, we've got 5 minutes. Mr. Smith?
Can you tell me who the manager of the Lily Kids, please?
Yes. May I bring the clerk in on this, because obviously he's the one who's financial officer and in overall charge of staff.
Yeah, the theatre manager, in the terms of the service level agreement, is Darren Crook at the resource centre. The service level agreement is with the resource centre, and Darren Crook acts as the theatre manager. However, we as a council own the building and therefore maintain the overall responsibility.
So Darren Crook's he's the manager.
Depends.
So on the notorious night stroke early hours of morning when the unlocked door and prowling cat incident happened, the only contact that the police had was with the two employees of the council. So they were called out on early hours of Sunday morning, had to hang around for probably 4 hours or so, and had to be paid overtime for that, and quite rightly so. The point I'm trying to make is, if Darren Crooks is the manager, how come the police don't have his phone number for contact, or the clerks, or yours? You know, why the two employees of the council? Why are they the only contact?
I could prove wrong, but I believe the SLA doesn't take into account any out of hours work that has to be done. And just to confirm, the primary key owners are the staff that you were talking about. Well, if it's the same people we're talking about, yeah.
So yes, you've got a manager who gets paid to be manager.
No.
And he's not a key owner.
No, he's not paid to be manager.
You've what?
No. The resource centre is paid to
So we've got one inanimate object that is in charge of another inanimate object.
Yeah, but we don't. The saying we pay a person is incorrect.
So you don't.
Pay for the service.
You what?
You pay for the service.
So 20 hours gets paid to the resource centre, not to Darren Crook.
That's correct. I'll talk about that.
So Darren Crook's his manager, but Darren Crook don't get paid. So he's unpaid manager.
How the resource centre organise what the contract is with the resource centre.
So we now in a situation then, aren't we, that if another incident like the unlocked door and prowling cat happens, then the two people that were called out last time, they'll be called out, and then we're paying premium rates for being called out. Is that correct?
If it doesn't change, then as far as I know, out of hours like that, primary appeals will be called.
The terms of the SLA, Mr. Smith, are for them to provide a service such as managed theatre bookings, promotion, the bar. The actual overall responsibility of this place, like I said, is our responsibility, hence why the maintenance team are the primary key holders to deal with out of hours emergency callouts. For example, say the pipe burst of the place went up in flames, it's nothing to really to do with the theatre manager. The theatre manager is a title of somebody who manages that service that we require under the terms of the SLA. An out of hours emergency contact is not one of the services that we
so
put to the agreement.
If we have a complaint with the manager, we complain to the resource centre.
You can complain to us because we are responsible for the SLA and we will deal with any complaint to do with the service.
So Darren Crooks is not the manager, the resource centre is the manager. Yeah?
Yep.
Okay.
Right.
I'm
not entirely sure, but I think we've given answers.
What did you say, Brian? What do you want to ask me, though? Sorry, you can ask me if you want.
No, we'll move on.
Are you asking how I've done the leaks are?
Right, that's absolutely perfect time because we've come to the end of the half hour. So I'll now close the public session and we'll move into the formal part of the meeting. The first part is apologies for absence. Right, move on to number two, which is to consider the matters determined as urgent by the Chair. I have nothing.
Chair, could I just raise it? Point of order. For the September meeting, I was advised that to put anything on the agenda, I had to submit an email or something in writing providing a brief summary of topics to be debated to enable all members to be able to take part in a fully informed debate. Basically, send any agenda items to yourself and the clerk. Tonight's meeting, I think there are at least six items on the agenda where we've got no information at all, there's no brief summary. I think the last month's meeting, there were at least nine items where we were provided with any information before the meeting. I just wondered why that was the case.
I'll look further into that to the clerk for you and make sure that the relevant information there, because you can't make informed decisions without relevant information.
No, we don't know who's placed these items on the agenda either, which is always helpful.
Right, well, if there's not a name, then it will generally be coming from general business through either finance officer, clerk, or accountant. If it's a member, then the member's name.
So items such as deciding the staff Christmas bonus.
That's coming from the finance staff.
From the finance staff, no. It was just as well on another point of order. In the standing orders, it says that items have got to be submitted before the last day of each month. We were provided with this month's agenda on the 27th of November. So that's 3 days before the last day of the month. So how can we put on the agenda?
Because that might be on this one.
Because also it's having all the success has to be issued 7 working days before the meeting. Working right through your working plan as well, sometimes it has to be before the end of the month. And normally it's mentioned at the meeting, or by email by me, that when the deadline is for submission items.
So do the working patterns determine the standard?
It's working days, I think.
Yeah, but it's just the situation's arisen where it's 3 days after the agenda's gone out, and the standing order says you've got till the end of the last day of each month. So I think that maybe needs looking to change it.
Okay. Can we move on to I need to move back to the agenda.
Okay.
Okay. Item three. So there's nothing in terms of urgency. Item three. Consider any matters which should be dealt with in open or confidential session. Does any member feel anything?
Yeah, I wonder whether the item 9A should be moved out. I don't know.
I was going to mention it right now, actually, but after members had asked. I feel that that should go into closed session purely simply because it's talking about financials of staff. Does anyone have any problems with that?
Under 1972, you don't have any choice, Chairman.
Sorry. I feel Mr. Smith's going to have a pertinent piece of information for us. Can I take a vote that he may speak?
You don't have any choice, Mr. Chairman, because under 1972 Act, you've got to put that into private session, because you're not allowed to discuss staff wages in front of the public. So it is a private matter, so yep. It needs to go into private session.
Thank you for your comments, sir. So we'll move. 9A, to close. Anything else? No. Item 4 is minutes of previous meeting. Just to be aware, this is just the formal side, to actually remove them as a true record, they're not the discussion. Page 1.
Previous item, Chair. The building.
which is why I'm saying it's quite a important subject, because I know it's run down, but it's a beautiful building.
Unless it's developed, it's going to get more run down and run down and run down and fall to pieces.
Right, on this subject, Mr. Smith indicated he'd like to give us some information. Can I show you to let Mr. Smith come in on this subject to the information
on it?
It's got to be pertinent to the subject.
Well, it is, but what I would like to know is that they're going to demolish Lawley. They're going to build 12 houses there. The next one's 4 houses, and the next one's 4 houses. So we've got 20 houses. Is that coming out of the amount of houses that the core strategy says that Diddington needs?
I would say it is, because the new houses that they've built where the old school was are part of that. So I would imagine anything else would be as well.
So it actually would negate building on the front line of road there, wouldn't it?
Well, that's going on to another subject, but certainly your question about whether this would be added into the list of houses, it would count towards it. Okay, so do members have any objections to that item? Application to determine whether prior approval is required for method of demolition and restoration for a site of Monksbridge Road. You've got the information there. Basically, it's the row of terraced houses near the water corner. Do we have no objections?
No.
Okay. Item C is details of demolition of existing buildings. There are two dwelling houses off Old Coast Road. Off four houses, sorry. You've got the information there. Just so you know where it is, it's the site next to the Throgmorton House. I think it's used as a distribution, or was used as a distribution warehouse.
Chair, I do think we ought to, the traffic problems here, I think we ought to show us concern about the traffic there, coming out of there, and then out of there. Because that's just over, more or less, on the back bridge. Well, it's like gradient in road, and then it just drops away there, more or less where the opening is. So I think we do show us concern about the traffic there.
That's not safe.
There is
there's a lot of traffic comes out of there now anyway.
Yeah, but the road does drop as it comes over the crest. There's a slight crest there, it does drop there.
Well, I mean, if it's showing concern with the road, to it at the same time, then there's a bit of a
problem. Well, that's if we show concern about it, you can do it come fast down.
Then there's a great deal. It's not an objection, but we show concern is for traffic problems. Show of hands. Okay. Item 4, which is the extension to the front, formation to new means of access for Kiddywinks Day Nursery on New Road. I did drive past and have a look, and what it looks like, although I'm not 100% sure, the right-hand side of the building comes out quite a lot more than the left, and how it looks is, looks like they're going to bring the front level all the way across.
Oh, I read this, Chair. They're not going to interfere with the car park piece at the front of that. But that the looks of this building is going to. So we're going to get a problem there with the whole people parking on the main road here.
No, if you look, it's like a canopy at the moment. I think,
because that's as far as we're going to go.
From what we can see from this, that's what I can see. So, any objections to that?
I've looked at this one. I thought there was another. They were going to demolish part of that stone wall, and that's it. Could make another way out of the car park in the front. Unless I read it wrong, but I thought that was what they were doing. My concern is that if you've got two a way in and a way out, and you've got parking on the beam, it's close to the bend where the zebra crossing is, I think that's going to cause more problems than it does at the moment with one way in and one the same way out.
I think it's, it looks a bit, Clive, it's just some poles going.
Well, I know they're extending the side there because it's straight up, but I mean through the existing stone wall, I thought we were taking another route out to that car parking area.
That would be coming a lot. Yeah, I see what you're saying. It would be coming a lot closer to.
They're putting like an in and out. At the moment, they've got one way in, and it's the same way out.
Yeah.
what they're going to do is create a new opening further on that stone wall, closer to the bend, and I think that's going to exacerbate parking and traffic problems along there.
We show concern.
Yes, that's
good. Well, that's possibly difficult, certainly within this.
Yeah,
yeah, there's not an objection, but we can show we have concerns with the entrance.
That's fair.
Yes. Yeah.
And there's agreed, not necessarily an objection, but concern about that entrance. Show hands.
It does show that on the drawing.
Yeah,
it does.
Thank you for that. Right, if we can move on to item 8, which is booking concessions and donations. We have none. Item 9 is for members' consideration and decisions. We have 9A, which is into closed session. So we'll move straight on to 9B, which is to approve meeting dates for 2015. Do we have suggested dates? So, as far as for general council meetings, same as we do now, second Monday of the month. We'll continue in a second. We need to agree preset meeting, and not necessarily at this meeting, but early next year we'll need to approve assets meetings and meetings and things like that, if members agree. I'll just, as it's a separate subject, I'm not entirely sure
what
pertinent information you've got on this one, but suggestion would like to come in on this. Show of hands if you're okay for me to speak.
Chairman, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but the best method to deal with this is that at the beginning of meeting, if the chairman actually takes a vote with councillors and says, will the council give the chairman the
discretion
according to the Act, you can.
No,
I mean, I've checked on it, and
it's got to be taken every time on every subject.
What is that in your standing orders, or is that?
Yes.
Because according to the Act, it says that can be done, that you can be given discretion. Because, everybody must get fed up with it, and I'm sure council must get fed up with it.
I'll look more into that one.
But I think you'll find that you can get that. If you do it to begin the meeting, you'll get that discretion.
We will look for it.
I raised this earlier this year before you had the annual parish meeting, and my concern was that you were losing one town council meeting to hold a parish meeting on the same day. My understanding was that they shouldn't be. I'll rephrase that. It would be better if you had the parish meeting on another Monday in between the monthly meetings, so you don't actually lose the town council meeting, because at the one in May, was it this year, I think? There was no business conduct by the town council. So
May's got to be the annual.
Yeah, but you can't. Yeah, May's got to be the annual meeting, but what you need to do is you miss sort of like a month's business there, because you have one in April, then you have another one till June, and the monthly meeting was lost in May. And my information from Yorkshire Local Council Association is that the parish council meeting, or the annual parish meeting, should be held on a different day than one of the town council meetings. And I wonder whether you could actually move that to the annual parish meeting to the week after the town council meeting, so they're on separate days. And then you don't actually lose a meeting.
We'll have to see a clarification on that.
I think that's the advice that they give, that you hold them on a separate day. Yeah. You don't have to try and have the two meetings, you have them totally separate. But then you're not losing the full council.
We're not
council
too rushed
meeting.
For that one yet.
You've got time to do that.
Yeah. Our clerk's going to seek clarification on it, and we'll bring that to probably...
And I said, if he wants to speak to the clerk at Anston, perhaps I'll tell the clerk out with how we we do it and give some guidance on it.
Okay. Well, we don't need to have any kind of guidance that we have.
We have 11 courts.
But we're not forced to
have them. We don't have to have it.
Four, I think, is the dream. 50% is actually what some can do. That's the only day really that we need to agree is the precept meeting. Now, obviously, it's always towards the end of January. We've got to do that because whatever's decided needs to be ratified in February so that we can get it forward. Obviously, the problem we have is that at the end of January, this place is completely taken up. So we've looked for other venues, and we can actually get the Middleton Institute for it. Tuesday the 27th in the evening. Members agree or decided that that's a suitable date for it. Members here present agree on that date? Okay. Item C, to decide whether to seek local sponsors for planters and produce orders. It's a verbal, really. Basically, we've been approached by various businesses to sponsor hanging baskets, planters, and things like that, specifically in Falcon Square. What we need is your approval for us to talk more with people, whether we want to do it or not. We're not talking how much we can get back at the moment, only your approval to go forward.
Well, I think we
Sorry, can I just bring, we're not turning on Robin Stone, so we have a question. Then planters, are they still under them for replanting them?
No.
I know we took it on, but have we took it on permanently, or is it, because I know it looks like it, but is this, if we start getting revenue off somebody, is somebody going to start saying, well, they know what to do with you? Because they're out, we should be doing that job.
It was limited, I forget what some of these meetings are called, but it was like local communities. For a different reason, we've been looking at the minutes of when these decisions were made, and it has been minuted, and we're responsible for planting those.
Because when money's involved, everybody comes out of woodwork, then.
Well,
it's not that
good,
though, is it? It's
about
a company
planting involved. Oh, no, it's about it's
not
bad.
Well, yeah.
We might have covered it a lot, but it's.
This is an example where we could really do some information being given to, not just a verbal update on it, you know, a bit more about who might have approached you, perhaps, and just to know where we stand with
well, it essentially is, yeah, what we can do is we can put a report if you. Prove that the principle of doing it, then what we can do is put a report together for you for consideration of who it is and the types of things that we're looking for. But tonight it's really do you want the principle of going forward with it, sponsorship?
Yeah.
So,
just a bit of background information to come by. It costs us about £3,000 a year to maintain all these points. Now, some of that is comes towards the planters at the cemetery, so we're not talking about that, and that has increased significance as council, as you pointed out, taking on all these extra ones from us, so it's just.
Yeah, yeah. It's just, I just wanted to clarify that soon as I say when money's involved, everybody starts saying, well, yeah,
we've seen minutes that we're responsible for.
Yeah.
So, just a show of hands for the principal to go forward with it.
Thank you.
Decide whether Dunnington St Johnstown Council is interested in establishing a community speed watching scheme. You have information there. Again, I'm not going to try and read, but I want my two penalties first. I ain't standing on a crossway with drivers shouting at me.
No, I'm totally against it. If it's part of police's job, part of the police's job, and that's what they get paid for, as far as I'm concerned. And you might all be stood there saying, as you said, if somebody stood on that main street or anywhere with a camera getting abuse out of motorists, they're welcome to it.
Can just hold, please, sorry, Paul. Well, we can discuss it all night, but does anybody have anything else other than what's already been voiced? So, show of hands that we don't wish to participate.
Thank you.
Right, move on to 10. At this point, I'm going to ask members whether they want a short break of 5 minutes or do you want to carry on? Carry on? 10A, to decide on requirements for a skip at the Park Avenue Cemetery. Do we need to bring Clark in and Rabbit on this one because it's done most of the work with it?
This was followed on from previous meetings. Last meeting, Councillor Scott raised this particular issue. In terms of this particular room in the spoil that's come out of the end of the big garage, which now stands at, to guess, about 60 tonnes worth of spoil. A couple of calls in, the skips, which was about £5,000, or a contractor to come in and remove the spoil that he spoke about 2004. Bit of an old rail, which is the cheapest option. And so we discussed it in the assets meeting last week. Not sure if we've got combined with another quote for the cemetery, which is the fence around the compound because the two roads are closely linked. The decision from the assets committee was that the two could be combined with a reduction in the efficiency savings. Because I think the two together with about 12,000. Nothing is being put in front of us.
Agreed.
why the draft minutes haven't been approved yet. That's why they've not gone to members. When will we, can we defer this?
Yeah.
Just aware of time. Yeah. We'll defer this one to the next meeting, and we will give the minutes of the asset meeting and the decisions. It'll also include quotes from, lots of quotes did come in from various contractors. So 10C again is probably going to do the same thing, although really good to with.
If we need all the information though, this is how things get drawn out and drawn out.
That's why the decisions were delegated to an assets
so
committee. Yes.
Cannot just
say
the information verbally.
Well, the assets is a committee, so we can make decisions. Really, bringing
well,
it to this is just
a
ratification. Yeah, or the trust committees. But if you talk about item C, which is decisions again, this is for roof repairs, registration of land, limit refurbishments. Wall strengthening for the cemetery. All this information went to assets, and we did receive three quotes for the different works. So if you.
Are the people on that committee not able to make a decision? We put
they've been delegated to make a decision.
Yeah. Yeah. Could
I just ask about that meeting? So it was lost. Wednesday. Is that actually public? Is that open to the public?
Yeah, yes, it is.
And it can be
found
on
the website. Chair has set out just as
set out. I think we have said before that if any councillors do want to attend these meetings, even if they're not actually put onto the meetings, they can actually attend any meetings.
Yes.
But you still should, it's like with the precinct, we still surely has to come before the full councils to make the final decision.
Yeah, but
we haven't got the information.
Not the assets, no. The assets were delegated powers to make decisions.
Yes.
There's some big decisions going to happen then, isn't there? Yeah, there's big money decisions going to happen. And then, you are for us.
Will there be an invitation sent out for the assets committee?
Well, what it just done for some committee?
Well, anybody can be
it's not committed.
No, was it sent out to everybody? Or was it just sent out to the committee? Because
these members, it would have just been
the assets committee.
Yeah. At the start of the year, the people who volunteered to go on it.
Yeah, but why? How can we go to a meeting without
well,
this committee?
That for all councillors being put on that email.
Because there's big issues here when you're talking about big major projects like this ceiling here, this room, it's a big issue that for just a certain number of people and the other people and the other members here don't even know there's a meeting. Or is it's all right saying you can attend, but if we don't know there's a meeting, we can't attend.
If I remember right, it was
him
one that brought me.
But with 15 members, and if we can't have an email sent to 15 members,
that's
what we're proposing. No, I'm not on about that. I'm on about if 15 members can't be emailed to just say there's a meeting of the asset committee.
Well, if it was on the asset committee.
I agree with you.
What, me?
Yes.
Yeah, because Roy's saying if you're on an asset committee, you'll know about it, but you've just turned around and said any member can go. Now, any member can't go if you don't know it's on.
I got
the information.
Let me just bring it back to the chair.
Matthew. On the assets committee, me and 7 members, do we receive that?
should come to
you said all these projects are happening. I don't know about any projects. Somebody says to me, you're having a new roof here.
You I don't know. But that's what council delegated powers to the assets committee. Yeah. There's no point saying you have the power to do something and then not
so,
do
so if you've got the power to do it, why are you on tonight's agenda? Have we got to ratify the decision? Surely, if they've already got that power, why are you bothering bringing it to
tonight? They've made the decisions and they're just bringing them to you for ratification.
Yeah. But we don't know, we can know what the decisions are, we don't know if they're trying to ratify. Once it's been provided, there's no information.
Which, again, is what we just said about the last one. Is this one the same? Can we defer? We can't with this. We've got to get it.
Yeah. If we don't have these committees, then everything gets discussed at these meetings and be about 5 hours long. So we could, as well as so you could be on, if you wanted to be, you could be on that asset
committee. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that. We didn't know about that meeting. It's all right after saying you could have come to the meeting. If you wanted, anybody's welcome to come to the meeting. Any councillors?
But it's not just one meeting. We have regular meetings. So
May I make a suggestion? One more second. The decision for the roof, not necessarily other decisions that were made that are in the draft minutes, is crucial that we get it done quickly. We have a problem. May I suggest that we have an extraordinary assets meeting next week? All members invited. It's an open meeting, so the public are invited, and we get a decision made then on what we're going to do. We'll put forward the information, the quotes, the contract. There's no contractors yet, because that's why we need to get moving forward on what we're going to do, so that we can invite for tenders. Do members, all members, happy that we organise a special meeting next week to discuss it? If that's what you need.
About the sort of like timing and closing and all that.
No, that's why I'm suggesting that we've got to get the decision done, so that's why I'm suggesting we have a decision next week.
The decision. Yeah. All
that
he needs to do is three meetings.
But if the assets committee has got the power to, why is it even on tonight's agenda? Just
ratify it.
You've already got the decision.
You can make the decision.
Point.
But we always.
Why do we say it is irrelevant?
Yeah. We always bring decisions back to ratification. Right, can we just bring Mr. Smith in? Do members have a problem with Mr. Smith speaking on this subject? Show of hands for him to speak. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Please.
Mr. Chairman, you're painting yourself into a corner in actual fact, because the asset committee is the asset committee. You've already got the committee set up. Councillors can't go to the asset committee as councillors and make decisions. The asset committee makes the decisions. That's the assets committee. So they can inviting all councillors or having a special meeting won't make any difference. And why you have to ratify it, I've no idea. Because if the assets committee have been given the authority to make these decisions, they make the decision. But councillors can't attend the assets committee as councillors and interject in the assets committee's meeting. The general public can attend the Assets Committee meeting as observers. They can't make any any interjection in the meeting, which is quite right. But the asset committee is the asset committee, and councillors can't go to that as councillors and overturn what the asset committee decisions are. Sorry, but you've made yourself into a corner.
Well, that's it.
You can actually make it bigger. You can make it bigger, but you can't. But you can't make it. You can't have it where councillors can go and to attend asset committee meeting as members of council.
Whether it's a matter of courtesy or not, we've always come back to ratification.
Oh, yeah.
Price?
I propose we ratify.
I second that.
Show of hands for ratification. Oh, actually, we won't. Okay. Those against?
I just propose we turn them back, that's it.
Yeah,
rather than failing.
So, the option to take the crowns out and
Come
back.
Yeah.
Well, the last time, we just trimmed them last time. We took them out, so if you take the crown out this time, we should do it a lot better. Instead of taking them all out altogether.
Yeah, because if you crown with them, it just stops growth anyway, so.
So the proposal to just go with taking the crowns out of the tree rather than felling the trees altogether.
Yes.
Councillor Dean, have a problem with that.
Graham, did you propose that?
Yes, I propose.
Second then?
I'll second that one.
Okay, Shaw Manson, go with that option.
Yep.
So I've taken 10D, which is to decide charges for allotments, cemeteries, and the local theatre hire and bar prices for 2015. It'd be given information tonight, it should be approved again. And this was emailed to all members last week.
Should this issue not be discussed at the budget meeting when we discuss the precept? Because I would thought everything should be looked at as a whole for the next year.
Well, normally we decide this information, which is general increases like this, we've always done, not in precept. If you say to move it in,
the reason I was just constructing the reason for that constructing is that any decisions now, yeah, you're there. And then be included in the process of discussion, so it's going to be a much more
important thing to do. Therefore, we need to discuss in depth. Based upon what we're looking for, is if you do agree to this, is that we will we accept the proposal.
Most of the inflation with regards to the specific bar prices is because the economy is filled out, which and there's extra revenue that we're missing out on the accountability. Also, it comes at prices just in line with other bars in the area, and with regards to the
right, item 11, which is the monthly accounts schedules, which you should have in front of you. And they were emailed before this meeting for members to look before they came. Anyone have any issues?
There are just a few issues here on this. I'm bringing this feeder families up again, these feeder pillars up again. There's three feeder pillars there from 31st of the 7th, 14th, to 19th of the 11th.
How can I continue to stop there? We know their estimates, we're still liaising with them now, but the meeting can be reduced to sort everything out. They're constantly going around the same way, we're getting in here to nail it literally to the chair to say, right, this is the experience that happened, this is the issue that's caused. We're not paying charges on this or that, kind of contract, we can't simply walk away.
Right.
We're basically saying tonight, we'll see these charges reduced by 50% or whatever, we're going to go away. We'll just build another supply. So you're right, we need to
buy. Yeah, because because when I brought it up last time, we did get the credit of 1,007.
We did.
1,007 pound back.
That's right.
Was it something like that?
Something like that.
Yeah. But I'm under the impression then they give us a credit and then they're still charging us.
Still taking estimates, and this is a whole bunch of service.
This is all the service. They give us £1,100 back, and then they load you up again. They load you up again with a max of £450 a year.
They haven't listened to what we've said to them before, complaining that they're not getting paid to.
Because
that is how we motor
courses. Do we use the feeder panels?
Most of them, other than the Christmas time, no, which is exactly why we have issues.
Because I suggest, if they don't get the finger out, we just stop contract.
Absolutely. That's precisely what we're threatening.
Well, I propose if we don't get that sorted out within a month's time, we stop the contract.
I'd like to suggest that we have a meeting first and see where we come.
Well, bring it to the next meeting then and see what's position.
We'll have more information.
It's about to be from that anyway.
Yeah.
And another thing, Chair, water charges seem to be very high from the Silverdale allotments. Nearly £700 for water.
Massively underestimated. And then they took an actual reading. So what's happened, if you look at the water charge over the year, and the budget for the Silverdale's allotment, it is the budget for over the year for the allotment is down on that track. What's happened in previous quarters, particularly the summer year, to be able to see it. They've just taken this to the way it goes, and then they took an actual reading, which you might as well.
The opposite to the problem that happened with the electric.
Can we make sure you do that again? Can we have somebody take a reading or something? Is it possible for us to take a reading? And then, because if it just goes on and on, you know, we're going to get another bill.
Yeah.
Either.
No, with water. With gas electric, you can't have another water or anything.
Sorry to keep. I'm under the impression, because I went at last meeting, that all these lights on contract now.
Which lights?
The light. The
lights that are attached to the 18 lamps, three lights. Right. Christmas tree lights outside the church at Kilitris.
Because we've hired the scissor with it as well. We don't have anything to do with it anymore.
No, we've still erected some of the old lights that have been fit flat to the wall, so we've got the scissor lift still, but we've got a reduced charge on it, and we've only needed to hire it for a lower amount of days than we normally hire it for.
Right, right. Thank you very much, Amy.
Any other questions on the accounts? Ideas for the precept for
year 2015-16, with basically accountant and finance officer putting together reports for the precept meeting now. If members have anything that they wish to be taken into account, looking at it at the precepts meeting, we need those by the 15th of January. That gives whoever is elected at the next election time to submit some ideas as well. If anyone, members of the public, feel that there's anything that's very strongly passionate about and should be on, if they can approach the member of the council and they can take it on for you. If we move on to 12, which is grants, there are none. 13, general matters, which has been running file. Okay, we've closed quite a lot of the items. One that's still open is issue 2, which is the apartment square. The correct artwork has been sourced, the replacement has been ordered, and we are still awaiting delivery. Clarks inform me we should have delivery of the artwork this week. Issue 5 is still open, which is a request from Greenbelt Group to put freedom information request in for the Birkdale site. Today we received a response back from the Information Commission, but we've not had a chance to look at it, so I can't really give you a report on what it's actually said. These documents you don't speed read. Well, a verbal report at the next meeting, once we've got to ascertain exactly where we are, maybe that we can give us some information. So, any other questions on that? Issue 9 is the throwing of sign, but I've still had no response back from anyone there who wants to take it on for us to support. Does anybody have any comments on that one?
Do you want to close that
one
now? I think
you
must have to close
that
response.
July.
Shall we close?
Do you want to close it?
I need to close that issue. I don't think we'll get a response.
Second door open. Sure, we'll have to close that answer. Clock's happy. issue 10. Defibrillators. We did have a meeting, and at the meeting it was decided that we purchased 2 defibrillators with their special boxes. One signed to be at the Salvation Army site at the US Road, and they would take on responsibility for not necessarily maintenance, but it does need a small amount of electricity, certainly in winter, to keep people warm and things like that. And they've agreed that they will do that if we put it on. And the other one to be sited straight outside here on the wall, and obviously the responsibility for that one is entirely ours. They are ordered, they are ready, and they are going to be collected this week. So again, approval's been made. We will contact the contractor to install and do the electricity for it. So fairly soon we should be seeing 2 up and running. I'll just warm that up a little bit, then I'll open it for everyone. We are trying to do a booking collection in various places, and up to now we received about £80 at the Christmas festival, and we did have a kind donation from another party which has made it up to about £230. I'm sure I'm not out of the way by saying it was Councillor Mitchell's charity event where he did the book and get nothing. We will be putting the buckets again at the carol service on Friday with planning permission from Les. And I think again we're going to do a book collection if we can to New Year. And if anybody else has any other suggestions where we can in Dillington do these collections, all it means is we get quicker to be able to look for another one somewhere else in the town. I'll bring you Les if that's alright, because you'll be the first one. Is that everything okay with that?
Yeah, no, you're fine. We're really, as I said earlier, we're looking at getting the ladies to interact out to give some lectures to the young people and that lot around here. So we're working closely with to bring them up to speed with these machines so that you know the next generation are there to
the arts of arts.
Yeah.
Getting rid of the fear
yeah.
People just use
it. The unknown of it. People yeah. Are afraid of them, but they're self-sufficient in the world.
So I need to contact you to arrange your installation. Yeah. Give me details after it's all visited.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay, there's no other questions on that one. I'll move on to item 14, which is date and time for the next meeting. Which is Monday the 12th of January. Agenda items to the clerk by 5 p.m. on the 31st of December. Okay. Right, if I can just finally, last item is not on, but I'd like to remind everyone that we have got an election on the 18th. Cards have gone out. And I'd just like to wish both candidates the best of luck. Thank you very much. Meeting closed.
Thank you.